Hello and welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home. I'm Marlo Artis and I'm your moderator. Tar Heel Teachers at Home is a video cast focused on engaging North Carolinians in conversations around education. Each week, I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. We'll start our introductions with our elementary school panelists.
Hi, my name is Amy Tarr. I teach 5th grade ELA and Social Studies for Clay County Schools, and you can find me on Twitter at Cards for Scholars.
Hello, my name is Cassandra Parsons. I'm a special ed teacher at Cumberland County Schools at Spring Lake Middle School. You can follow me on Twitter at CParsonEC.
Hello, my name is Micah Tweetmeyer. I'm a biology teacher at Riverside High School in Durham, and you can follow me on Twitter at Micah J. Hunter.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Arisha Smalls, and I am the Elementary AIG Program Specialist for Cumberland County Schools, and you can follow me on Twitter at Smalls Arisha.
Wonderful. For this episode of Tar Heel Teachers at Home, we have the great pleasure of speaking with Maureen Stover. Maureen is the 2020 Burroughs Wellcome Fund North Carolina Teacher of the Year. She just was named North Carolina Teacher of the Year this Friday, and we're really excited to have her on. Maureen, welcome back to Tar Heel Teachers at Home.
Thank you so much, Marlo. I'm really excited to be here tonight.
We're really excited to have you back, Maureen. So take us into Friday's reception. What were you thinking right before as the announcement was being made? And at what point did you realize that you were indeed the new Teacher of the Year for our state?
So, the other 8 teachers that are in the cohort for the 2020 Regional Teacher of the Year team are amazing educators. They are phenomenal, they are smart, they engage their kids in their classrooms every day. And so honestly, among that great group of peers, I thought any one of us could have been named Teacher of the Year, and I would not have been surprised by whoever was named Teacher of the Year, with the exception, of course, of myself, because I thought, I'm around all these other amazing educators who are inspiring me every day. And so I was not expecting my name to be called. But as Superintendent Johnson was calling out and giving some information about the new Teacher of the Year, there were 2 clues that kind of made me think, I think it might be me. And the first one was he talked about EVOS projection data, and that's something that I do a lot of to try to figure out where my kids need help and what they understand really well and where they still need some additional assistance in order to really master the content and get mastery of the objectives. And then he also said that the new Teacher of the Year taught in a college setting. And so as an early college teacher, I'm teaching on the campus of FSU in a Cumberland County school. And so when he said that, I thought, okay, I think it's probably me. I was not expecting it, but I'm definitely very honored and humbled to have been selected as the 2020 Burroughs Wellcome Fund North Carolina Teacher of the Year.
Wonderful. And Maureen, you're actually the first teacher from Cumberland County Schools to be named the North Carolina Teacher of the Year. Ruby Murchison was actually the Teacher of the Year in 76, but she was with Fayetteville City Schools, but you're the first one from Cumberland County Schools after the merger. So tell us about Cumberland County Schools. You actually taught in Florida and then you came to Cumberland County. So talk about Cumberland County and what that district means to you.
So I really love living in Cumberland County. I did teach in Florida. My husband was in the Air Force, and so we've moved around quite a bit. I began my teaching career in Florida, and then I spent several years working as an educational consultant for the National Science Teaching Association. And then when we moved to Cumberland County, I wanted to start getting back into the classroom. And so my husband decided to retire from the Air Force, and we decided to make Cumberland County and Fayetteville our home. And so I'm super excited to be teaching here. And Cumberland County is, a really unique place because you do have a lot of influx because of the military families, but you also have a lot of families that are from North Carolina. So you get this really cool dynamic of people that have grown up in Fayetteville, North Carolina, their entire lives, along with people that are coming in and infusing some different ideas and bring in, different cultural pieces. So we have a lot of really diverse kids and a lot of really diverse families in Cumberland County. And I think that makes us very unique. And I think it's one of our strengths. In my speech that I gave, I said, I think the diversity of our team will be our strength. And I think that diversity is our strength also in Cumberland County, because we just have lots of different viewpoints, lots of different perspectives. We have lots of people who are excited to come into our community and get involved and be engaged and do what they can to make our community better. And I think that that ends up making us a very strong community.
That's wonderful. What questions do we have for Maureen?
I have a question, Maureen. So with the current health crisis, Corona is crazy. We all know that. And lots of teachers have worries and fears, concerns, anxieties about returning to school in the fall. But can you talk to us about what you feel teachers might be excited about when school returns in the fall?
I think teachers are excited about seeing their kids again. I mean, we are all educators because we love being with kids. You know, I say that education and my kids are my ikiga, which is a Japanese concept for the meaning for your life or what gives your life worthwhile. And I think that's the case for a lot of teachers, that they love to be around kids. And I know during the COVID-19 stay-at-home order, when we switched to remote teaching, I could still teach. I could still deliver instruction. It wasn't the same as getting to deliver instruction with my kids in the classroom. But what I missed a lot was kids coming in my room in the morning and asking me to print papers for them. Or I had kids who would come in and like see some crazy video on TikTok that they wanted to try to redo in my classroom, or walking to lunch with my kids because we have to walk across the college campus to get to the lunchroom. Having them come in the morning and tell me, you know, silly TV shows they watched or about a book they're reading. And those are the things that as teachers we also love, because we love those pieces that aren't necessarily directly connected to instruction but are still part of our kids' social emotional learning needs. And that's right now what I'm really missing, because that's I can't replicate that in an online lesson. You know, I've still been trying to connect with my kids through email. I've still been connecting with them through Remind. I've tried to find other creative ways to continue engaging them and connecting with them, but there's nothing like walking into your classroom in the morning and having kids come in there and be excited to come in and see you.
I have a follow-up question to that. I saw a video that was circulating with your announcement for winning Teacher of the Year, and I heard you use that term before, your ikiga. Can you tell us how you happened upon that term?
So I am a Asiaphile. I love things from Asia. I love things from Japan. I use like Japanese pens and Japanese planners. I love things from Asia. And a couple of the books that I had read, I'd seen this character, Ikiga. It's actually two characters that are put together, Ikiga. And I was curious to learn more about it. And so I actually went to the library and I found a book about Ikiga and I started reading it. And I realized that it really spoke to me, because it talks about the thing that makes you super excited every morning to wake up. And for me, that was school. And so I've kind of latched on to that concept and, you know, like keep that concept in the forefront of my mind, that my kids are my ikiga, teaching is my ikiga.
Thank you.
So I lived in Japan when I was in first, second, third grade. My father was in the Air Force also, so go blue. My question to you is, it's not a question. Yes, it is. Can you talk to us about your childhood experience as a student, and how does that compare to students in the 20th century?
Absolutely. So I grew up in Charleston, West Virginia, and I was actually very fortunate because Charleston has several large chemical plants. So they bring in a lot of diversity into the school system. So in the public school system, my classrooms were full of kids from all over the world. And so I really had a great childhood growing up and learning that people weren't all like me, but that I had a lot in common with those people anyway. And that I could learn so many cool things from them because they had different experiences and they had different cultural backgrounds. And so I think that's something that we still see in classrooms today. So that would definitely be a commonality, that we have, you know, kids from all over who have different ideas, different experiences, and learning how to help kids harness that diversity and then turn into something positive where they help their classmates understand differences, but they see it as a strength, I think is something that we're still seeing happen in our public school system today. Now, of course, because I went to school in the 1970s and 80s, there were no computers. The kids cannot believe it when I tell them I didn't have a cell phone until I was 30. And that when I was in high school, we would have to type our papers, and that I had a manual typewriter You know, where you'd have to like do that, like push really hard to get it to type on the page. And if you made a mistake, you had to use this like whiteout stuff to try to fix it. You know, for them, that's shocking to hear that. And so I think that, you know, now with the technology that we have in our classrooms, there's so much more that we can do for our kids. You know, I love trying to incorporate technology where it's appropriate in my classroom to really help my students be able to experience things that I can't bring into my classroom. You know, so like, I can't bring the Galapagos Islands into my classroom, but we can put on Google Cardboard and we can look at a really cool scene under the ocean in the Galapagos, and they can still see the Galapagos tortoises, even though we can't actually travel to the Galapagos Islands. Or we can look inside of a volcano, even though there's no way we could really go down into a volcano. So there's some really neat things that we're able to do with technology. But because I did grow up in that paper pencil era, I still do a lot of handwritten things with my kids. So we do a lot of doodle notes in my class where they're doing coloring and they're drawing pictures, and it keeps their brains engaged, and it helps them find ways to be able to organize the information in a way that works well for them. So I do try to still pull in some of those old school things that we learned to do when we were kids, because I feel like it really does help them organize the information and helps them learn the information better.
So my follow-up question is, what was your deciding factor to become a teacher, and who were the influential people in your life?
So I actually didn't begin as a teacher. I actually graduated from the Air Force Academy, and then I was an intelligence officer in the Air Force. And I had some really fantastic teachers in junior high and high school that really got me excited about science, and I had always loved science, and I knew that science was what I wanted to major in college. And then as I was looking at transitioning out of the Air Force, my son was in kindergarten, my oldest son, and his kindergarten teacher needed help. And so I would go in at lunch as a parent volunteer. And I found that I had a real knack for working with the kids who didn't quite get it in whole group instruction. So I was really good at pulling, you know, like the kids who needed some assistance with like vocabulary or with sight words or with sounding out letters. And I really loved it. And I thought, you know, this would be something that I could really see myself doing. And of course, with a degree in biology, it was a fairly easy transition for me to go into a teacher preparation program to get my teaching license and then go into teaching. I'm so happy that I did, because it is definitely my calling. I absolutely love it. It has been just a fantastic career for me. And I honestly can't imagine myself doing anything else other than working with teenage kids.
Thank you.
Maureen, I read that you were really hoping to advocate for more socio-emotional learning. What do you think that should look like in schools, and what is your kind of dream for kind of pushing that movement forward?
So, you know, when I think back to high school, there's not really a whole lot of content that I remember. Like, I know I learned content, but there's not really a whole lot of content I remember, and especially being a science teacher, a lot of what I teach my kids today may be irrelevant by the time they're my age. But what I do remember are my teachers who were there for me, my teachers who, you know, gave me confidence when I was struggling, I was afraid of something, or helped me make it through a tough period in my life because I, you know, just needed, and I needed somebody there to give me guidance or just kind of give me that confidence or that be that kind of guiding hand behind me, just helping me out. And so what I really think that we do for kids in any school setting is that we provide them with the tools to be really successful adults. Some of those tools are learning how to take notes and learning how to wait in line and learning how to wait their turn or to, you know, to have a disagreement with someone, but have it be a disagreement where it's going to be a civil disagreement, you know, like when we do like a Socratic seminar or philosophical chairs or something, and learning how to navigate that. But also a lot of it is understanding that you as a person are important and your ideas are valued, and that you as a person have wisdom, even if it's not wisdom that shows up on a test. And if you don't get everything right, that's okay. And so I really feel like in schools, we need to start focusing on those social emotional learning skills, helping our kids navigate that so that they are better prepared when they walk out of our classrooms to be the adults that we know that they can be.
Maureen, you talked about EVAS a little bit at the beginning of the show, and that can be a stressful topic for students and parents and educators and administrators. So I was wondering if you could speak to why you think that type of data is important and why data collected, in particularly by people other than the students' educators, is useful for those educators and students.
So the EVAS data that I use is the projection data. So I'm not really looking at necessarily how they did in my class. I'm looking at how they did previously, because that gives me an opportunity to know on day one when kids come into my classroom, at least a ballpark idea of if they're gonna be really strong because they've been strong previously, or if they're a kid that I'm gonna wanna spend a little bit of extra time with at the very beginning of the semester to figure out exactly where they are and what I need to do to help them. I then collect data on nearly everything that they're doing. So if I give them a reading assignment, a homework assignment, a lab assignment, a group assignment, if it's just a discussion that we're having, anything we're doing, I'm collecting data, and then I'm putting that into categories based on learning objectives and based on the clarifying objectives that were established by the North Carolina Essential Standards. And then I'm able to see gaps. So like if I have a student who's doing, let's say, extremely well on a photosynthesis standard, but they don't understand cellular respiration and they don't understand that photosynthesis and cellular respiration are related to each other, then I know I need to pull that student for one-on-one remediation to go over that material with them again, or find a different way to teach it to them in a way that they understand. And I teach in the early college, which means that I get students from all of the middle schools in our entire county. So, you know, sometimes I think, you know, if you're teaching at a high school where you have a flow of students that are coming from the same science teacher in eighth grade into your program, and you know kind of what they have learned, it's maybe a little bit easier to not have some students that have gaps. But at our school, because we're getting kids from all over the county, I have some kids that understand everything coming out of eighth grade. I have other kids that understand nothing coming out of eighth grade, and I have kids that are somewhere in the middle. And I want them all to be confident when they leave my classroom that they're really good in science. And by analyzing that data, I can do that. Now the kids don't realize I'm analyzing the data at all. They have no idea how I know what they need help with. But magically, when they come in for tutoring or when I pull them for one-on-one remediation, when we're doing small group activities, they're like, when they walk away from their table, they're like, that's exactly what I didn't understand. I don't know how she knew that. And really, it's not magic. It's just that I'm paying attention to every single thing they're doing. And I've designed the instruction so that every single thing that they're doing directly relates back to something measurable for me, so that I can help make sure that they're learning everything the way that they need to learn it.
So I know this year you're going to be stepping out of the classroom, but for a while you might have been thinking how you would adjust your data analysis system, you know, starting with your new students, since they've been out of school for so long, there could be a lot more gaps than usual. So how had you thought about tweaking your system if you were going to be in the classroom this fall?
So one of the things that I was planning on doing, if we were going to be either 100% remote or in the blended learning model where I wouldn't have kids in my classroom all the time, was to schedule some like one-on-one rooms or small group rooms with kids, so that I would be able to monitor how they were doing. Because, you know, when I have all 35 of them on at once, some are typing questions in the chat, some of them are raising their hand and asking questions, but I have a lot of kids that aren't engaging in the classroom in that large Google Meet session. And so my plan was to have some small group or individual, if my students needed individual pullouts, where I could work with them one-on-one to kind of assess them and see how they were doing. And then I was also revamping anything that I had done where it normally would have been like a question, like where I would ask them a question and they would respond back to me. I was revamping all of that into Google Forms. That way I would be able to email it to them and then they could give me their answer and then I could see their answer back. I also started using Flipgrid, which is a really great way for the kids to answer a question back to me and then I can assess whether or not they understand the concept. They also think it's awesome because it's a video and they can put stickers on there or they can like add text to it. And so they thought that was really cool as well. So Flipgrid was another really good way for me to kind of collect some information and some data on them just to kind of assess where they were and to make sure that they were learning what they needed to learn.
Awesome.
So Maureen, one of your mantras is service before self. And so how does that play out in education now around COVID-19 with so many educators having anxiety about going back to buildings, thinking about the concern of their own health, the health of their students, the health of their family members? How does that all fit together in your mind?
So, with service before self, I think, you know, that for me, that is not necessarily putting my health at risk, but more, you know, like if something needs to get done, like for instance, if my kitchen needs to be cleaned versus getting a lab ready to go for the next day, I'm always going to get the lab ready to go for the next day, right? So, so I would, or, you know, if it's me staying after school for an extra 40 minutes to help a student because they need help on a project or they need help with an assignment, I will stay after school with them, not say, oh no, I need to go home because I need, you know, I need to be just hanging out and make it in time to watch TV or something. So with the COVID-19 though, I think it is very important that educators are making sure they're taking care of themselves and they're taking care of their families. And I think that that's definitely a concern because if our educators get sick or if our educators are in some way unable to teach our students, we are gonna begin to run into problems with having enough adults in the classrooms to take care of kids because we're of course limited on the number of subs. And so I do definitely understand the concerns that teachers have with going back into classrooms. And, you know, I used the example when I was talking to my parents about COVID-19 and I said, you know, if you give kids at a table, 10 kids at a, or you have one kid at a table with 10 kids glitter, how many kids have glitter on them? My dad said 10. And I said, no, all 100 kids in the entire school, because that's just the way that things happen, right? I mean, kids touch everything. And you know, we're going to be very vigilant and making sure we're cleaning stuff and sanitizing things and doing everything we need to do to try to keep our students as safe as possible. But, you know, the teachers are definitely going to have to make sure that, you know, Lysol is there and protective equipment is being used and we're doing everything we possibly can to keep ourselves safe so that we're not bringing the virus home and getting sick or potentially getting any kids at school sick as well. So, yes, I think the concerns that teachers have and the anxiety that teachers have, I do think it's warranted because I think that there is definitely reason for concern.
Mm-hmm. You can also say that too with your science background, understanding how viruses and all that work. So you have the teacher side, but you also have that science background.
Right.
I'm so Maureen, it's not a secret. All the protests and the different things have been in social media lately. And we know as educators that we are going to have to address some of these issues in the classroom. So my question is, how are you going to approach this? And can you talk to some of the teachers about, it's a sensitive situation. So can you give them some things that they can possibly say to the students and how to carry that conversation in the classroom?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, you know, I do think that that is a very important topic, and I think it's always been an important topic. It's definitely highlighted now because of the protests, but I think it's a topic that teachers have always needed to address and was always important for teachers to address. You know, we are a multicultural country, and that means that everyone's cultures need to be represented and everyone's cultures need to be respected. And, you know, I try to live my life in a way of love and acceptance, and my kids see that. And I think that's really the best thing that teachers can do with their students is to lead by example. So, you know, we need to have the conversations with them. We need to have discussions with them. We need to give them classrooms where it's open and honest, and they are not afraid to bring up topics that maybe are uncomfortable to them or scary for them, and know that they have teachers that are going to be there and listen to them and care about them and try to help them find solutions or try to help explain why things are happening. You know, and I think that it's very, very important that teachers are in a listening mode, that teachers don't jump to trying to tell their kids what they should be thinking or try to tell their kids how things need to be, that the teachers take a moment to listen to their students, hear their students, and then discuss it with their students so that their students kind of learn how to navigate those discussions. I also think it's really important for teachers, especially if they're teaching in a school that is a demographic that's different from them, that they are taking active roles to make sure that they are anti-racist. And not that they are against racism, but that they are actually anti-racist. I've suggested to several of my colleagues that they read the book White Fragility, because it is a fantastic book, and it really causes you to think, you know. And another fantastic book that I just started reading is Blind Spot, which is another book that really causes you to think. And I think that all educators, it's our responsibility to make the next generation better. Each generation needs to be better. And that's our responsibility as educators. And so I take that to my heart, that it's my responsibility to try to make things better every single day. And so I think it's important for teachers to take proactive steps to look at them and also reflect to themselves. Like, do I ever say anything? Have I ever done anything? Have I ever portrayed myself in a way that would have made a kid feel uncomfortable, or made a kid or an adult feel uncomfortable, anyone feel uncomfortable? And if I have, then I need to reflect on myself and figure out, what do I need to do to ensure that's not happening? And so I think it's a very important conversation. And I think, you know, we also probably need to have some professional development to help teachers have some skills, so that when we reenter classrooms, as those conversations begin to come up, because they will, teachers already have some skills that they know are effective strategies to help kids as we approach those discussions.
Thank you.
Maureen, last year, the Cooperative Innovative High Schools faced some funding cuts, and thankfully, you know, those funds were allocated so that the programs can continue. Can you talk about the importance of the Cooperative High School? I mean, you've been at Cumberland International for several years, so talk about the importance of those Cooperative Innovative High Schools for the state of North Carolina.
One of the things that makes us very unique and is very important is that our mission is to try to help first-generation underrepresented minority kids get a four-year college degree. And so I feel like, you know, we are a very unique program, and I feel like we're a very important program, because every day our entire school is geared toward helping these kids and getting them where they need to be. And so, you know, and we're also very unique because we have the opportunity for our students to be able to start going into the college classes their junior and senior year of high school, and they're with college professors and they're in actual college classes, but they have the high school teachers right there that when they need help, they can come back in our rooms and get help. So, you know, I usually have a room full of kids at lunch, or like kids who will pop in my room during my planning because they need help studying something or they didn't understand something. And sometimes, as long as they don't bring me English, we're good. If they bring me English, I have to send them to another teacher. But, you know, but anything that they need, we're there to help them, you know. And so I think that makes the early colleges a very unique program, and all of the collaborative high schools a very, very unique program, because we are small. We are really dedicated to the kids, and our goal is to get those kids so that they are going to be successful through that four-year college program. And we've had a very good track record. So, you know, it's so amazing to see kids when they graduate with that four-year degree and they come back to visit us. It's thrilling to see how excited they are and how proud they are. And they know that they've done it. And for many of our students, they're the first person in their college or first person in their family to graduate from college. And that's also just amazing. And so it's really thrilling to be part of that program and to see those successes for our kids.
And in addition to being a earth science and biology teacher, you're also an Abbott CHU teacher. So talk to us about the importance of the Abbott program, because it's not as widespread across the state as it should be, because it can be very beneficial for students.
Absolutely. So Abbott is Advancement Via Individual Determination, and it is a program that is also designed to try to help those first generation kids be successful in a college program. And so it fits perfectly with the mission of our school, and that's the reason why we are an Abbott school. The Abbott program really focuses on helping kids develop study skills and reading skills and vocabulary skills, organizing, being able to ask good questions, because, you know, that's one of the things a lot of kids struggle with in college is they don't understand something, but they're not even really sure how to ask the professor the question. So we practice that a lot, like, how do you actually ask the questions? And so it really does help prepare our students when they get into that four-year college program. Because we're an AVID school, we actually do AVID across the curriculum. So a lot of AVID schools would have an AVID elective class where the kids would go to an AVID teacher and they would do AVID strategies in that class. But then once they leave that class, that those AVID strategies would not be reinforced in their other classes. At our school, those AVID strategies are enforced at every single class. So it doesn't matter when they are in science, we're still doing AVID strategies. When they go to math, they're still doing AVID strategies. And so I think that also really helps our students, because since it is like across the curriculum and in every single class they're using those same strategies, they become second nature for our students. So when they go into their four-year college, they're ready to go because they already are using those strategies every day. So it's just what they do to learn.
Are there any other questions? So Maureen, my last question that I have, you're very involved in your school. I mean, you're a faculty advisor for numerous things. How have you really reconciled the fact that you will not have students on a roster this upcoming fall because you're making your transition?
Yeah, I think, you know, as a teacher, that's hard. But on the flip side, I have an opportunity to advocate for all of the kids in North Carolina. And I have an opportunity to advocate for all of the teachers in North Carolina. So while I am very, very sad that I will not get to see my kids every single day, I know that this was the right decision because it gives me the opportunity to help more kids. You know, and I've already told my kids, I'm like, you guys can still email me. My email's staying the same. They can still text me on Remind because they all have that, you know. So I'm sure I'll be getting messages from them if they need help with something. I also know I'm leaving them in really good hands. So the teacher who was the other science teacher in my school is going to take over biology and earth science. And she's a phenomenal teacher. And she just finished up the beginning teacher program. And she's fantastic and excited. And the kids love her. So she's going to do a great job. So I know I'm leaving them in good hands. I know my principal, Ms. Ford, is fantastic. And she's also a science teacher before she became a principal. And so, you know, I know that she's going to make sure that all my babies are taken care of, because she's gonna make sure that they're in good shape and that everything's going well for them. So, while it is definitely difficult to step away from them, I know that I'm doing it for the right reason, and I know that I will still be able to help them and then lots of other kids in North Carolina by taking this position.
Absolutely. Well, we certainly congratulate you, Maureen. We're grateful for the opportunity to speak with you. We had the first exclusive interview with the 2020 Burroughs Wellcome Fund North Carolina Teacher of the Year, and we're very happy about that. And we hope that you'll come on our program again.
I would love to. Thank you.
Just don't come next week, because you were here last week, so you can't come next week.
I'll skip a week and come back 2 weeks from now.
Thank you so much, Maureen. We would like to also thank our wonderful audience so much for watching this program. We hope that you will continue to engage us on our social media platforms. Please follow us on Twitter. Our handle is @TarHeelTeachers. Like our Facebook page, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and on all of our social media platforms, please use our #TarHeelTeachers. And if you have time, visit our website, tarheelteachers.com. We'd like to thank our wonderful group of panelists for joining us for this episode, Amy Tart, Cassandra Parsons, Micah Tweetmeyer, and Arisha Smalls. And once again, we would like to thank our special guest, Maureen Stover. She is the 2020 Burroughs Wellcome Fund North Carolina Teacher of the Year. We look forward to seeing you all next week on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.